Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 9327 in the name of Richard Leonard on new vessels for the Clyde and the Hebrides, arrangements to deliver vessels 801 and 802. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Richard Leonard to speak to and to move the motion on behalf of the Public Audit Committee. Mr. Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I begin by reminding members of my register of interest and by thanking the clerks and staff for their tireless work on the production of this report. Today we debate the findings, the recommendations and the conclusions of the Public Audit Committee's report, New Vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides, Arrangement to Deliver Vessels 801 and 802. It is a report grounded in the extensive evidence we gathered over 7 oral evidence sessions and from a wide range of written submissions. Now, it is a matter of record that some of the evidence the committee took is the subject of dispute between the various parties who spoke to us. But what is not in dispute is that the people of Scotland and our island communities in particular have been badly let down, that there has been a widespread failure of decision-making and of leadership across government agencies, and by those previously running the yard, which goes back almost a decade. And let me tell you who else have been badly let down. Those workers in that yard in Port Glasgow. They have witnessed highly paid managers, turnaround directors, and countless external consultants and advisers all come and all go, when all of the time, if only they had been listened to, it is my sincerely held belief these vessels would not have ended up being 5 years late and 3.5 times over budget. Since the committee published its report at the end of March, there have been a few developments. We have had 2 transport ministers and now looking for a third, a new cabinet secretary, a new deputy first minister and a new first minister. In New Leadership, A Fresh Start, the first minister told us it is imperative that transparency underpins our approach to delivery. My government will ensure the people of Scotland have the information they need to hold us to account. But governments are judged by what they do, not what they say they do. So I am duty-bound to report to Parliament that time after time, in the course of our investigations, we found poor record-keeping of key decisions within the government. We heard of ministers, up to and including the former First Minister, holding meetings with a private contractor behind closed doors, with no permanent civil servant present, for which no minute exists. A senior member of the Cabinet refused to answer the committee's questions until requested to do so for a third time. This should not just trouble the 5 members of the Public Audit Committee, it should trouble every single member of this Parliament. Delays occurred in securing the attendance of some senior civil servants. Delays occurred in receiving evidence from Transport Scotland, with little or no explanation provided for late or incomplete information. Correspondence, which could not be found for the committee, later turned up in response to a Freedom of Information review. So let me be as clear as I can be. If a committee of this Parliament seeks evidence from the government, it should be provided in full. It should not be dependent on a member of the public or the press posing the same question. Taken together, these actions show a serious disregard for openness and transparency. They also demonstrate an unhealthy disrespect of the work of this Parliament, which makes it all the more disappointing that the Scottish Government's written response to the report that we are debating this afternoon was late, lacks any real substance or detail, and simply fails to address at all half of the conclusions and recommendations. No response on the role of Transport Scotland, no response on the procurement process, No response on ministerial conduct. No response. It was issued in the former Transport Secretary's name, but in fairness to Kevin Stewart, he was acting on behalf of the whole government. So there is a collective responsibility here, which I hope not only the Cabinet Secretary, but the First Minister will accept. The committee in our report also stressed the importance of full transparency around written ministerial authority. We therefore welcome the Cabinet Secretary's recent action. And while we recognise that the value for money assessment by external advisers, Tenio, may contain commercially confidential information, it is in the public interest. It is in keeping with, to use the First Minister's own phrase, the imperative of transparency, that as much of this assessment as possible is published in the coming days. Our report also recognises the very serious allegations made in the BBC disclosure investigation. Claims that FMEL was allowed to progress beyond the pre-qualification stage of the procurement process despite being unable to meet requirements which were mandatory. Claims that FMEL also had preferential access to restricted technical information to help inform its tender bid. Of course, it's right and proper that these most serious allegations are thoroughly investigated, that there is a due process. But CMAL is wholly owned by government ministers, which is why we call once again this afternoon for a commitment from the government to share the findings of the KC-led inquiry with the Public Audit Committee and with this Parliament. We also call in the report for the Auditor General to undertake a comprehensive audit of the entire procurement process, to audit the full cost of this project from start to finish once the vessels have been completed, and to have a laser-like focus on the £128 million of public money which was paid out to FMEL by undertaking a forensic audit of all financial records to establish exactly where the money went. Before I finish, let me turn to the role of Transport Scotland. As we conclude in the report, the programme steering group which it led was weak and toothless. That despite having a critical role in communicating important information to Scottish Government ministers on CMAL's behalf, it appears to have repeatedly failed to do so. We were even told at one point that Transport Scotland had no role in the contract, when it clearly had a central role in the contract, which is why we have fundamental, deep-rooted concerns about Transport Scotland's position, which the new Transport Minister must address. Finally, we were able to reach a significant degree of consensus in the report. The one area where there was some division is over the involvement of Scottish ministers. The majority of the committee concluded that it was wholly inappropriate for a Scottish minister, in the middle of a live tendering exercise which he was overseeing, to reply to a constituency MSP that alternatives to a full builder's refund guarantee had previously been acceptable, because in so doing, he compromised the integrity of the procurement process. Similarly, the former First Minister's decision to publicly announce the preferred bidder for the contract, even when, in the words of her own media briefing, I quote, significant negotiations were still to be concluded, most certainly weakened CMAL's negotiating position with FMEL, not least over the builder's refund guarantee. As a committee, we are clear that record and note-keeping fell well short of what we would expect. So there is a failure of ministers, but it is a failure of the civil service too. So it is, of course, encouraging that the Permanent Secretary has issued new guidance on the recording of decisions. But as I said to the First Minister 2 weeks ago, he and the Permanent Secretary must now mount a wider review of government accountability and transparency to Parliament. Because this report is not a report simply about value for money. It's also about trust and confidence. It's about whether the machinery of democracy itself is working in the way that it should. It is about the principles of democracy. It is about the standards of good government, of open government, of transparency, and yes, of honest government. In the end, This is also about respect and regard for public accountability and for parliamentary scrutiny. Yeah. It is about whether we treat democracy as a right and not a privilege, not just for members of this parliament, but for the people we derive and the government derives its power from. That is my deepest conviction. That is what is at stake, the democracy and trust of the people. On behalf of the Public Audit Committee, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I would remind all members who would wish to speak in the debate to please ensure that they have, in fact, pressed the request to speak button. I would also advise members that we do have some time in hand. And on that note, I call on the Cabinet Secretary, Neil Gray, a generous 8 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I would like to put on record my thanks to the previous Transport Minister, Kevin Stewart, who was due to open this session but has this week resigned for personal health reasons. I'm sure, like me, colleagues wish him well and thank him for his service. I'd like to reiterate our thanks to the Public Audit Committee for its detailed and in-depth work in preparing this report that builds on the significant work undertaken by the Auditor General in production of his own report into this matter. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the staff of Audit Scotland for their professional and detailed approach to compiling that report, and also concur with the convener in terms of thanking the members of the committee and the clerks for compilation of the report we're considering today. Can I reiterate at the outset, Scottish Ministers regret for the delay to the ferries. I fully understand the distress and difficulty caused by this, and I apologise again to our island communities for the unacceptable delays in the delivery of vessels 801 and 802. As someone who grew up in an island community myself, I know very well the challenges of living in an island community at the outset, never mind when your connections are disrupted in the way that they have been of late. The Scottish Government has made it a priority to engage directly with communities and hear from them in relation to these impacts and to look for solutions to alleviate the pressures on the ferry network while we await the delivery of these two vessels we consider today, alongside the four new ships being constructed in Turkey. And as we noted in response to the committee, I want to welcome the report's recognition that there has already been significant improvements in procedures and processes by Transport Scotland and CMAL working alongside CalMAC since the procurement of these vessels almost 8 years ago. Improvements have already been made in relation to the governance of port and vessel projects, and further work is ongoing within the tripartite to strengthen this further. Many of these have been adopted prior to either the inquiry into these matters by the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee in 2020 or the Audit Scotland report. And this has included consideration of the role and remit of the Programme Steering Board. More recent key strategic recommendations have been channelled through this body and have been broadly welcomed by communities. This has included provision of a resilience vessel at the splitting of the Sky Triangle services and plans to enable 802 to be deployed alongside Glen Sannox to Arran. And following the REC inquiry, Scottish Ministers confirmed that a review would be undertaken into the existing structures to ensure they were fit for purpose. We have now published Project Neptune and are engaging with communities on possible future arrangements. And we have been clear that the community view is key to this, and we are keen that we move at pace to implement the change that communities need and deserve. Presiding Officer, when it... Of course.
Graeme Simpson.
I have a couple of questions for the Cabinet Secretary. First of all, when are we going to find out the Government's view on Project Neptune and what the future arrangements should be? And secondly, is he going to address any of the recommendations in the report which we're debating? For instance, does he agree that there has been a significant lack of transparency and accountability throughout the project? Start with that one.
So, in terms of Project Neptune, that work is ongoing, as Graeme Simpson will know. And in terms of the other elements of the report, we've responded to it. I'll come to that shortly. We've responded to the report's recommendations. and have done what we can to ensure that we're giving as much information as possible, including live in terms of information that we can give as far as possible in terms of the ongoing situation. So, Presiding Officer, when it comes to the future of Ferguson's Marine, we are committed to securing a sustainable future for the yard following the completion of 801 and 802. Our decision to take Ferguson's into public ownership saved the last commercial shipyard on the Clyde from closure, rescued more than 300 jobs, ensured that the two vessels vital for our island communities will be delivered, but also, Presiding Officer, preserve businesses in the local community upon which Ferguson's is relied upon for their viability, as I've heard over recent days from local parliamentarians Stuart McMillan and Ronnie Cowan, of course.
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Can I ask, before they nationalised the shipbuilding yard, was there any work done to look at how much it would cost to maintain the original Ferguson's and the workforce at that time? Because a lot of the workforce left and you had to rehire a lot of new people.
Cabinet Secretary.
So obviously there were challenges that emerged as the work went on. Of course, there was due diligence done in terms of the nationalisation. Of course, circumstances change, as Brian Whittle has suggested, and that is something that, of course, we build into our learning from where we have to make these industrial interventions to ensure that we continue to plan to make sure we can respond as effectively as possible. But I make no apology for the fact that what we did to nationalise Ferguson's was to save the jobs, save the last commercial shipyard on the Clyde, and ensure that ferries were going to be delivered for our island communities. I'll make some progress before I come back to Mr. Halker-Johnson. More detail on the work at Ferguson's I'll provide in my contribution later, but I want to address some of the comments made both today and previously by the convener of the committee. At the recent convener's meeting with the First Minister, he suggested that we had cherry-picked the recommendations that were responded to and used very few words. Don't agree with these comments at all, and strongly refute that there was any such approach. We carefully reviewed the report and extracted the recommendations that were populated through the chapters. We did, of course, also present our detailed evidence and responses to the issues in the report directly to the committee as part of the evidence sessions. And more importantly, we have accepted many of the recommendations put forward to ensure that we continue to strengthen future vessel procurement processes and build on previous work. This includes confirming any use of written authority on the Scottish Government website, welcoming and agreeing the suggestion of having greater written clarity in shareholder authorisation and written authority and how this should be sought for CMAL, reaffirming our commitment to undertaking a robust lessons learned exercise once the construction of the vessels is complete, and emphasising that all parties will engage fully with and support Audit Scotland on any further work to be undertaken. However, there are areas in the report where no conclusion is reached, leaving statements as observations. We did not respond to these directly where there was no recommendation attached, but again, these were addressed throughout evidence sessions. The convener himself just said there were 7 oral evidence sessions, including with the former First Minister. And of course, if there are further areas where the committee would welcome feedback, we will seek to provide this. The Scottish Government is committed to transparency and has proactively published more than 200 documents on its website, and we have cooperated at every stage of the PAC inquiry, as well as those previously undertaken by the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee and Audit Scotland. Throughout its work, the committee had the full participation of a range of senior officials across a number of departments, all of whom had full respect and regard for the parliamentary scrutiny led by the committee. It includes Transport Scotland, who endeavoured to provide all information to the committee in a timely manner. And I understand there was finally, the committee also received evidence directly from the former First Minister, as I've outlined. I can also confirm, as it's been raised again by the convener, that CMAL, through its lawyers, has commissioned an independent investigation by Barry Smith KC into the allegations raised about the procurement of vessels 801 and 802 in the BBC disclosure programme from last year. Once completed, CMAL will carefully consider its findings and consider what can be shared with Parliament and the committee. Whilst our view is that there is a need for transparency and openness on this serious matter, I must stress that it is for CMAIL in the procuring authority to consider next steps as a result of the investigation. I'm sorry, I'm going to need to conclude. I'm coming to my conclusion. I will draw my comments to a close. I'm going to be available, obviously, in closing statements as well. I will draw my comments to a close again by thanking the Committee on Audit Scotland for their work on this report and assure the Chamber that we're progressing the matters we have committed to and detailed in our response. This Government will continue focus on the replacement of the ferry fleet and improving service delivery with communities at the heart of that process.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I now call on Craig Hoy to open on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Again, a reasonably generous 7 minutes. Thank you,
Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to start by thanking the clerks and the staff of the Scottish Parliament Public Audit Committee for their support in compiling this detailed report. It documents a shocking series of bad decisions and poor practice, culminating in two ferries, three times over budget and 5 years late. Yeah. Ferries which have still to set sail, one of which it would now be cheaper to scrap and start all over again. Long-established procurement processes simply not followed. A story of key decisions not being properly recorded. Of ministers failing to account for the decisions they took, of key documents going missing, of the ministerial code broken, the biggest blank cheque in the history of the Scottish Parliament being written, standard maritime construction processes dismissed, financial safeguards and standard builders' refund guarantees simply disregarded. I will take an intervention.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank Craig Hoy for taking an intervention. Just on the point of the blank cheque, surely the biggest blank cheque was actually the building of this Parliament, when actually the SNP weren't in power.
Craig Hoy.
I said this Parliament, you might have realised the blank cheque was written, in that case, before the building of this Parliament. So on that basis, there is no point there. This Government wrote the biggest blank cheque in the history of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament, and the people are now paying the price. This is a story of an SNP Government failing to respond time and time again, openly and transparently, to legitimate questions. Yeah. And regrettably, and I say this regrettably, this is also a story of SNP members of the Public Audit Committee blatantly seeking to undermine this report in a cynical bid to get their ministers off the hook. And all the while, it is Scotland's island communities who are paying the price. Deputy Presiding Officer, let me turn to Audit Scotland's original report of March 2022. That report made clear that Scottish ministers approved the contract award to Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited in October 2015. They did so despite knowing the significant risks caused by FMEL's inability to provide mandatory refund guarantees and also set against the severe misgivings of CMAIL. As Scotland's impartial Auditor-General has said, there is insufficient evidence to explain why Scottish ministers made that decision. And, Presiding Officer, the worst part of all of this is that no minister has come to this Parliament to take responsibility for the tragic comedy of errors that has unfolded. So let's look at some of the evidence that we took and some of the key conclusions of the report. Jim McCall told us that the ferries being built at Ferguson's are, quotes, obsolete and will spew out what he described as poisonous gases. Morag McNeill, the interim chair of CMAIL, told us that the preferred bidder announcement risked the entire procurement process. She said, and I quote, "Our preference was for that to be done on a confidential basis and for there not to be a public announcement." The former Transport Minister, Derek Mackay, admitted that there had been a catastrophic failure at the shipyard. Colleagues will know that this report was not agreed with the unanimous support of the committee, and that is regrettable. Mm-hmm. In public, and perpetually, and sometimes petulantly in private, SNP committee members chose to dismiss the evidence which was clear and which was overwhelming. Yeah. A close examination of the report reveals that some of the core conclusions that Mr. Beattie and Mr. Coffey sought to delete or dilute. For example, Richard Leonard proposed that additional wording be added to refer to the poor judgment shown by Derek Mackay and to reflect that the integrity of the procurement process had been compromised. Instead...
Point of order, Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, President Officer, and thank you for taking this point of order without any notice. I'm quite concerned that Mr. Hoy appears to be putting on record or quoting things that happened in a private session in a committee, and I'm seeking your guidance on whether that's permissible.
Please, I thank Claire Hawkey for her point of order. I did wonder myself, but it's not entirely clear to me what the facts are and whether or not Mr. Hoy is referring to a private session of the committee, and perhaps Mr. Hoy could elucidate the matter.
I'm referring to the appendix of the report that has the breakdown of the divisions that took place at each point, and in which case each motion that was put before the committee is in the final report. So I'm quoting from the final report. And the appendices, I'm afraid the appendices, you're going to have to listen to them, because the appendices are littered with further examples. In relation to Keith Brown's shocking attempt to dodge scrutiny by repeatedly stonewalling legitimate questions from this... yes, a good question. Where is the former Deputy First Minister? Where is the former First Minister? Where is Mr Brown? They're not here. Instead, they have put...
Ms Hawkey, we don't need to have the sedentary chit-chat. Mr Hoy, please. And that would apply also to Mr Simpson.
Let's look at Mr Brown's shocking attempt to dodge scrutiny. The committee's draft report concluded, the lack of cooperation we experienced from the former Cabinet Secretary for Investment, Infrastructure and Cities is also a matter of serious concern. Yeah. Mr Beattie's response, to argue that we should hit the delete key again. Now look, Mr Leonard also proposed additional wording to reflect that CMAL's negotiating position was almost certainly weakened by the public announcement of the preferred bidder, as CMAL itself said to us. The conclusion that we reached in draft form is reasonable, and I quote, the committee is not convinced that such a public announcement was necessary or indeed appropriate for this project, especially at a time given the considerable work and negotiation that was required before CMAL could take a decision to award the formal contract. We believe that this almost certainly weakened CMAL's negotiating position with FMAL. Mr Beattie's response again, to try and hit the delete key. But SNP members didn't stop there in their attempts to whitewash the report on behalf of the ministers. The report draft stated, it also remains unclear why the First Minister led on the preferred bidder announcement and why the First Minister's press release and associated social media communications did not reflect that there were significant negotiations to be concluded. Again, SNP members disagreed, voting in vain to try and remove this passage. And they were similarly obstructive when it came to following the money. On the use of the £10 million loan to FMAL, the report's conclusion was clear. The committee considers that transparency over the use of public money is essential. This example falls, we said, well short of the standards of transparency we would expect. Isn't it strange that a member of the Scottish Parliament's Public Audit Committee, and that stage also a treasurer of the SNP, could take issue with such a conclusion? Perhaps now we know why there was such an absence of financial control that allowed the SNP to sneak a motorhome onto its books without, apparently, the knowledge of its very own treasurer. And when it came to the meeting between the First Minister and Jim McCall, a meeting where the recollections of the two protagonists differ significantly, again there was an SNP attempt to neuter the committee. The report concludes, record and note-keeping of these meetings was weak and fell well short of the standards of transparency and accountability that we would expect. It continues, it is particularly concerning that there does not appear to be a full record of the meeting held between the former director of FMAL and the First Minister in May 2017. And it concludes, a permanent civil servant should have attended and produced a record of that meeting in line with the established protocols in the Scottish Ministerial Code. Deputy Presiding Officer, yet again, Willie Coffey and Conor Beattie sought to play down criticism of this government by seeking to remove elements of this clear account of that evidence session. I don't have time. In the end, thankfully, their attempts to divert, to dilute, to distract and delete legitimate criticism of the government did not succeed, and the report stands as a very solid piece of work, and I thank my colleagues for that. But the SNP did not only seek to attempt to amend the report, they also sought to undermine the report. Upon its publication, a statement was released by Mr Coffey and Mr Beattie through an SNP spokesman. It said, the headlines chased by the committee convener significantly embellish the actual substance of the report, which offers very little in the way of new information. Shame. For the record, shame. I disagree with this view entirely, and I support the convener in his conclusion that the people of Scotland have been badly let down by SNP ministers. Deputy Presiding Officer, having reviewed 16 hours of scrutiny and thousands of pages of evidence, only a lame lapdog or a lackey could have come to a different conclusion. The Public Audit Committee's verdict on the SNP's long-running ferries fiasco was fair and proportionate, and our report identifies a series of failures on an unprecedented scale.
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. I now call on Neil Bibby on behalf of Scottish Labour. A reasonably generous 6 minutes, Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to speak on behalf of Scottish Labour in this debate. I wish my colleague Alex Rowley a speedy recovery from his recent planned surgery, and I also wish Kevin Stewart well too. I almost always say when starting my contributions in this place that I welcome the chance to speak in the debate, but I have to say there's nothing to welcome about one of the biggest public procurement disasters in the history of devolution. Ferries, 3 times over budget and 5 years late. I do want to thank, though, the Public Audit Committee, particularly the convener and its officials, for their extensive work that was done in spite of the difficulties they encountered, as outlined by Mr. Hoy. The motion today asks us to note the conclusions and recommendations of the report. I not only do that, but I want to put on record that I agree with those recommendations, even if the SNP members of that committee, who try to remove any criticism of Scottish Government ministers from the report, do not. And I would say to them, almost everyone with any sense in Scotland knows that the Scottish Government is ultimately responsible and at serious fault for this fiasco. The attitude and failure of those SNP committee members to fully recognise this reflects very badly on them indeed. This week on South Uist, like every week in many of our islands, we see the impact of this debacle and people paying the cost of this government's failure. Of course, we need to look at how our ferry services are run in the future, but the number one reason why people in Scotland don't have a reliable ferry service is because we don't have a reliable ferry fleet. Despite what the First Minister claimed earlier in this chamber, over the last 16 years, only 6 ferries have so far been built during the SNP's time in office, 6 in 16 years. Compare that to 10 ferries built by the last Labour Liberal Democrat government in half that time, 10 in 8 years. Because of this fiasco, we're now having the situation where our ferry network is in crisis and we're having to build ferries in Turkey. And we're also having to pay £1 million a month for the catamaran MV Alfred as a relief vessel. Presiding Officer, the Public Audit Committee's report sheds a light on how this situation came to pass and a series of concerns over the SNP's financial mismanagement and irresponsibility. It also highlights the considerable lack of transparency and accountability from all those involved, including government ministers. From FML not being open about their inability to provide the full builder's refund guarantee, to our First Minister himself in his position as Transport Minister, exercising poor judgment, in the words of the committee, and stating they had no knowledge of the preferred bidder when evidence suggests he did. The entire scandal has been characterised by the complete opposite of transparency. It is little wonder that there are still so many unanswered questions. Presiding Officer, in particular, serious questions of competition and serious concerns over the integrity of the procurement process remain, which compromises public trust. The findings of the KC inquiry must be shared with this Parliament, no ifs, no buts, and in full. And I will say to the Cabinet Secretary, it isn't for CMAO to tell us what they will and won't share with this government. That report needs shared in full. No ifs, no buts. And I hear the Cabinet Secretary making comments there, I couldn't make them out. I would welcome clarification from the Cabinet Secretary that the KC findings will be given to Parliament in full with no redactions. Presiding Officer, no one in government has taken responsibility for this. We've had a merry-go-round of ministers who once couldn't get down to the yard quick enough for a photo op, who are now desperate to avoid any association with this fiasco. Real responsibility would be a government minister taking their position on fixing this mess and seeing out the job until it is done. The government have also failed to hold senior management accountable too. Senior management who should not have received a penny of bonuses for these ferries delayed and over budget. To add insult to injury, the former turnaround director was paid £2 million despite overseeing more delays and increasing costs. People don't just want to hear the government say, "I agree with you, that is wrong." They want ministers to get their money back. Presiding officer, there's a lot of blame to go round for this fiasco. Ministers, agencies, management. But the one group of people, as the convener said, who have been entirely blameless throughout this is the Ferguson's workforce. In fact, if the warnings of the GMB union had been listened to earlier, we perhaps wouldn't be in this mess now. It's vital we listen to them going forward. Along with Alec Rowley, I met GMB shop stewards, Alex Logan and John McMonagall, at the yard some weeks ago. They are calling for investment of facilities in the yard. They're also calling for the yard to be directly awarded smaller, simpler and standardised vessels to secure a positive future for the yard and for the workforce, work that can easily be done at the yard, as has been demonstrated before. The Ferguson's workforce should not be judged against these two vessels. The Ministry of Defence work from BAE is a vote of confidence in the yard, and the Scottish Government should follow suit by awarding the contracts from the small ferry vessel replacement programme, but with robust oversight in place. We need a national ferry building programme that gives our islanders the ferries they deserve, but builds them efficiently here in Scotland, not in Turkey. Nor should the Government sell off the yard now. This is the Government's mess. Therefore, it's the Government's job to clear it up and to help restore the reputation of the yard. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the report has highlighted a lack of financial responsibility, a lack of transparency and ultimately accountability, inadequate oversight of the entire situation, start to finish, and finally a complete disregard for stakeholder engagement. And despite what SNP members of the committee may think, islanders, workers and every taxpayer in Scotland are paying the price for this SNP government's incompetence and financial mismanagement.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. And I now call on Willie Rennie to open on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats, and a reasonably generous 6 minutes to Mr. Rennie.
Deputy Presiding Officer, apologies, but as agreed, I won't be able to remain for the conclusion of this debate today. I need to attend a teacher's event up in Aviemore this evening, but I can assure members I will be listening online throughout my journey to the Highlands, and that is honest. I also want to recognise the contribution of Kevin Stewart to ministerial office, and I do wish him well with his health. His health is more important, to be frank, than any job. And I also want to thank the committee, the clerks and the opening contribution from the convener in his usual passionate style. When the Economy Secretary announced to the Parliament that he was issuing a ministerial direction ordering Ferguson's to complete the two ferries, overriding the value for money test, he just couldn't resist. He sought to make a virtue of that decision in the wake of a humiliating admission that it would be cheaper to scrap the boat, the second boat, and start again elsewhere. He thought it was time, just let me conclude the remarks, he thought it was time to claim credit for the decision, making a virtue while taxpayers picked up the tab, the shipyard workers were humiliated, and the islanders were on the march. The truth is, he had no choice. To choose any other option would lead to further delays and would finish the yard for good. But just because he had no choice does not mean it was a good decision. There is little in this sorry saga that has been a good decision, and I'll take an intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
And thank Willie Rennie for giving way, and I'm glad that he provided the additional context around the decision that I took, because it was a narrow value for money assessment that I proceeded with written authority over. That did not take account of the impact of the community, nor of the yard, nor of the island communities, should there be further delay. So does he accept that with the context of that wider consideration, of course this was the right decision to take?
Willie Rennie.
But who created that context? It was this government. It was this government that made a series of terrible decisions over many years, many of which Richard Leonard outlined in his opening remarks. It's been an expensive episode. The mistakes have been so costly that if we had awarded the contracts elsewhere back at the start and sent every Ferguson worker home with £300,000 in their back pocket, we'd still have change left over. A third of £1 million for every worker to sit at home, and we'd still have two ferries. In fact, we'd now have two ferries sailing to the Isles, serving the islanders and also the communities that we seek to represent. And the Minister thought it was wise to take credit. He had hardly flinched when he opened the taxpayer's chequebook to sign a blank cheque, spending taxes that have been raised by nurses who battle through the pandemic, by teachers working long hours to keep up with the demands of the job, by workers in a fish factory on a 12-hour shift juggling three jobs just to make ends meet. Perhaps the Minister should think of those people the next time he seeks to blithely spend millions of their money. The ownership of this fiasco is not in doubt. Remember, it was the SNP that brought in their favourite businessman to run the yard when he'd never built a ship in his life before. Remember, it was the SNP who awarded the contract to the yard. It was the SNP who interfered in the procurement process, who interfered for party advantage, who interfered with the builder's guarantee. And remember, it was the SNP who took over the yard when it collapsed. Yet the Minister thought he should take credit for saving the yard when it was his government that put it in decision that was potentially under threat. We thought we'd seen the worst, but the fury in the faces of the islanders from South Uist tells you just how angry they are. Lines of cars parked up for as far as you could see at Loch Boisdale. 600 people rubbed shoulders to make their views known. That is about a third of the population of South Uist and Eriskay. You'd need 500,000 Glaswegians in George Square to match that strength of feeling. They are angry about the lost bookings. Businesses are under threat. Income has been lost. Missed hospital appointments. Weddings postponed. Empty shelves in the shops. And what's worse is this government isn't even providing a penny of compensation. Ministers are content to issue a ministerial direction to spend millions more at Ferguson's, but not a penny for the shopkeepers of South Uist. They are happy to shell out £1 million a month for the MV Alfred, but not a penny for the B&Bs on Eriskay. They sit idle while Ferguson's pay millions in bonuses to the bosses, but not a penny for the islanders. Apparently, the money would be better spent by CalMac. CalMac! Apparently, it's for the greater good. Haven't we come to a pretty pass that those who have suffered the most at the hands of this incompetent government are lectured by ministers of this government about the sacrifices that they need to take to for the greater good? For goodness sake, stop the faffing. Give the islanders the compensation. End the insulting boasting about the virtue of this government's decisions. Do the right thing.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. And we will now move to the open debate. I would advise members that at the present time, there is some time in hand, so that can be factored in. Obviously, if that changes in due course, the Chair will advise members, and at that stage, any interventions would require to be accommodated within the members' speaking slot. And on that note, I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Brian Whittle. Mr. McMillan.
Thank you very much, President Officer. First of all, Brian Whittle asked the Cabinet Secretary a question earlier regarding the yard. Generally, Mr. Whittle, the yard was a working museum. It had received very little investment in that building, and also in the kit in that building. The workforce was still actually using kit going back to the 1940s, trying to build ships. And that was when the yard was under private ownership. Also, sometimes nationalised in the 1970s, but the yard had a complete dearth of investment for decades. I'll take Mr. Whittle since
Brian Whittle.
Yes, the question.
If that's the case, why did you award the contract to them in such a bad condition?
We need to speak through the chair, Stuart McMillan.
So, as the Cabinet Secretary indicated earlier on, obviously due diligence had taken place,
We need to hear Mr. McMillan's contribution.
With the investment that's going to go into the yard to try to update the yard, as it clearly has, and anybody who's actually been in the yard, I don't know if Mr. Whittle has or hasn't, but anyone who's actually been in the yard will see a lot of the investments actually went into that yard since 2014. Another point, actually, just I wasn't going to touch upon this, but on Project Neptune. I've got grave concerns about Project Neptune.
And I've already written to the Scottish Government about it. I mean, a number of us in the committee, in this chamber, have already attended some of the events that were hosted by the then Transport Minister, Jenny Gilruth. And as a consequence of them, I did write to the Scottish Government because I generally feel as if Project Neptune will actually be potentially a wasted opportunity. And on Willie Rennie's points, I genuinely was really shocked that Willie Rennie's comments regarding the yard, clearly, according to Mr Rennie, well, he wouldn't have actually stepped in to save the yard. The yard would have been shut. Just 1 second, Mr Rennie. The yard would have been closed. And he's talking about £300,000 per employee. That would have been potentially just for the first two ships. So what would have happened since?
Willie Rennie.
At no stage did I say I wanted to close the yard. What I did say was that I wanted this government to do things properly. And if it had done things properly, we wouldn't be in this situation today and we'd have two ferries. But the government failed. Does he not accept that?
Stuart McMillan.
What Mr Rennie said was he would have awarded the orders to elsewhere. That's what you said, Mr Rennie. So that's what Mr Rennie said. As a consequence, the yard would have closed. There would have been no yard, no workforce at that place. So, presiding officer, one of the things for me about this whole situation is I want to put on record my appreciation for the workforce of Ferguson Marine. Now, this workforce, whether intentional or not, have been dragged through the mire in the whole story, and it has been completely unfair on every single member of that workforce. So this is where sections 226 to 231 of the committee report are extremely helpful. Now, the workforce at the yard have the skills, they've got the ability and also the experience. And they want the best for the yard, and that's a sustainable and prosperous future. And I gently highlight to the Chamber, I gently highlight that the continual hammering of the yard does nothing to improve the morale of the workforce, nor their hopes and aspirations for its future. I've already taken a few, Mr Simpson. The narrative needs to change so that the yard actually can develop the future that we all claim to want. Now, with that saying, also, I'm keen to ask the convener of the committee a question. Now, he used the word rigged on the BBC GMS programme on the day of the publication of the report, yet that word doesn't appear in the committee report. In the sections 84 and 85 of the report cover this, with section 85 stating, and I quote, "While this is a serious allegation, the committee does not, in this report, draw conclusions from the BBC programme." Now, surely the convener would accept that using that type of language, even when paraphrasing somebody else, only plays into the hands of those who want the yard to fail.
Richard Leonard.
No, Mr McMillan, I've been fighting for that yard and for those workers and for those jobs for decades, so I'll not take lessons from you about who's on the side of the yard or not. If the word rigged was used, it would be a quotation, because that is the expression that was used by the team that produced the BBC disclosure programme. They said it was a rigged process. The committee's position isn't that we endorse that, but I would be merely reflecting that in an interview with the BBC.
Stuart McMillan.
Well, that's certainly not how it looks to the transcript convener. So, presiding officer, I fully support the actions that the Scottish Government have taken in actually helping to save the yard in 2014 and also 2019. And the awarding of the two vessels fairly secured the yard's future. Now, make no mistake, we have heard in this chamber and outside in recent months, if the orders went elsewhere, the Scottish Government would have been quite rightly criticised, and I would have been leading the campaign for the orders to actually go to the yard. Now, Neil Bibby has already touched upon the issue of work going to Turkey. If we didn't have the yard, then these orders would have went to Turkey as well. Now, we wouldn't be having this debate today, or many of the others that have already taken place in this Parliament, if the order went elsewhere. Instead, the residents of the new apartments that would surely have been built on the site of the former shipyard would be enjoying their views over the Clyde, living beside Newark Castle. Now, saying also, as far as the workforce, the Port Glasgow community and myself are concerned, Ferguson Marine must remain a shipyard for many decades to come. Now, the pie-in-the-sky ideas about shutting the yard and moving it to Inchgreen dry dock is a non-starter. In addition to those wishing to buy an apartment in Inverclyde with a view over the Clyde, there are plenty of places to go to see that. Shipbuilding in Port Glasgow must remain. Now, I welcome the fact that much of the committee, this committee report helps the reader understand more about the situation that has happened. And I know, however, that it is not clearly a unanimous report, as members have already touched upon. I also want to touch upon a factual inaccuracy, which centres around my letter to the Scottish Government and the subsequent reply. I became the MSP for Greater Inverclyde in 2016, not before. And I'm sure that Duncan McNeill would not be too happy about being airbrushed out of his earned position at the time as sections 86 to 93, but also preceding and subsequent sections contain this factual inaccuracy. Now, looking specifically at section 89 and the reply from the Scottish Government, I'm sure that a similar section and a division would have appeared if the then Cabinet Secretary or Minister had either not replied or replied providing no information. And as section 88 of the committee report states, and I quote, the constituent MSP for Greenock and Inverclyde was undertaking his duties as an elected representative by approaching the then Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Constitution and Economy to ask what alternatives to a BRG existed in a bid to support the shipbuilding industry in the area they represent. And I stand by my decision to write to the then Finance Secretary. I was content that the Minister at the time provided information which I clearly shared with FMEL and the committee. Now, what decisions are taken thereafter was a matter for FMEL. Now, Presiding Officer, I think that the oral evidence document, documented in section 156 of the report is also important to highlight.
Ms. McMillan, I'm being generous, but I think we need to start.
Sure, okay. I'll finish this point, if I may, then, Presiding Officer. I think that the quote from the Chief Executive of Transport Scotland was interesting, and I quote, it's, we still had the outcome of the procurement, which told us that it was the best bid for price and quality, and we had secured some negotiations of risk from CML to Ferguson's and from us with CML. Presiding Officer, I will not apologise for our government stepping in to save the yard, saving the jobs and getting those ferries finished, because that certainly is going to provide a future for many, many people in my community in the decades to come. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms McMillan. And I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Willie Coffey. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I do welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate. Can I thank the Public Audit Committee and their clerks for their work in delivering this report and bringing this debate to the Chamber. And I have to say, it's almost uncomfortable watching SNP members trying to defend the indefensible in this debate. Because we are debating a ferry scandal going back many years, resulting in an eye-watering overspend that is three times the initial budget. Still no ferries, and the island community is now cut off from supplies and livelihoods. £338 million for two ferries. From start to finish, this has been an unmitigated disaster from the SNP. It started with a dodgy procurement process mired in allegations of being rigged that announced Ferguson's as the preferred bidder without the mandatory building fund guarantee as highlighted by the Auditor General of Scotland, Transport Scotland and CMAL. A shipbuilding company at odds with CMAL and the government, leading to it going into administration, a staged launch with painted-on windows, missing meeting records, a First Minister who somehow couldn't recall vital information and meetings when giving evidence to the committee. Over 50 times she couldn't recall, let's not forget. And finally, if that wasn't enough, we now discover that Hull 802 will not be value for money, sure, and it would be cheaper to re-procure a brand new ferry. Yet the Scottish Government keep on digging. This is on top of designing a ferry that won't fit into the port from which it was procured to sail from. You could not make this up, Deputy Presiding Officer. A credible, sensible government faced with these problems would apply the rule, when in a hole, stop digging. But the Scottish Government, however, continue to dig the hole, employ highly paid consultants to explain why they're right to keep digging the hole, and then if it doesn't work, just keep digging faster. The final play, I have no doubt, will be a Cabinet Secretary pains to explain why this mess is somehow somewhere else. But the reality is that the Scottish Government have now dug a hole so deep for themselves and for the island communities that our next Transport Minister is more likely to be found on Bondi Beach than Barra. The Scottish Government's track record in rescuing failed businesses is that of one flop after another. And it may well make these investments with the best of intentions, but time and again they end in failure. And what's worse, they don't seem to learn from the mistakes. The biggest issue for me here is the apparent total lack of commercial knowledge being shown. Even if we accept, quite reasonably,
the Scottish Government stepping in to take over a business like FML isn't necessarily about making a profit for the Scottish Government. There's a worrying impression here that there is no limit to how much money they will pour in. There is a time and a place for the Scottish Government to step in and prevent a build... Of course.
Mr. McMillan.
I thank Brian Whittle for taking intervention. Now, with his comments, I've listened very intently too. So is Brian Whittle suggesting that Hull 802 should be scrapped? And as a consequence, if that were to happen, then that would certainly have an adverse effect upon the workforce and the future of the shipyard.
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank Stuart McMillan for the intervention. What I would say to him is the Scottish Government have got them into a position here where the only decision they could make was to complete the Hull of 802, as Willie Renehan said, but it's their mistakes that are costing the Scottish population and the taxpayers money upon money. It's ridiculous. But there is a time and a place for the Scottish Government to step in and prevent a business failure. But in these cases, there should be a clear due diligence to understand the scale of the financial commitment, a clear commercial plan of what's needed to turn the business around, and crucially, a properly defined set of criteria for exit. We've seen at Prestwick Airport, however, there's a lack of a clear exit path, leaving what should be a commercially viable business sitting on a Scottish Government balance sheet, with offers from the private sector to buy the airport rejected, assuming there's even acknowledgement given that we discovered last week when questioned in committee by my colleague Graham Simpson, the Cabinet Secretary didn't even know there had been a note of interest to the purchase of Prestwick. The most crippling problem facing all these businesses is the same. The sheer ignorance of how business works within the SNP's leadership, compounded now by the detachment from the economic reality that the Scottish Greens have brought into government. In committing to save the yard, the Scottish Government set out three objectives. Complete the vessels 801 and 802, safeguard jobs and give the shipyard a future. And I see that a failing in at least two of these. And as I said before, I think many of the original workers were lost and the new company had to hire many new staff. Given the colossal cost overruns and delays that have come for it, it's hard to believe there wasn't a better way to achieve the same goal. What would have been the overall cost had the Scottish Government decided to support the original Fergusons, which it was at least being run by business people, rather than nationalise a company when the cost had soared to an unacceptable £130 million? Now we sit at £338 million, with four new ferries having been procured without the Scottish Government's own shipyard even on the tender list. Shocking. This, Deputy Presiding Officer, is why the SNP Green Coalition Government should never be allowed anywhere near business decisions. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's inability to recognise their catalogue of mistakes and their commercial ineptitude leaves island communities cut off to the ruination of their way of life. Platitudes from the First Minister with woolly promises of a resolution by 2027 leaves us wondering how many islanders will be left to welcome the ferry when and if it indeed finally arrives. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Widow. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Paul Sweeney. Mr. Coffey.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I think you'll find that the SNP members in the committee agreed with substantial critical elements in the report. And so the offensive comments by Mr. Hoyne Bibby are pretty disgraceful, but sadly not unexpected these days from these two parties. Mr. Hoy could have said what he said about me and my colleague Colin Beattie at any time at all, but said not a word. Tawdry and cowardly, Mr. Hoy. He also has a brass neck, Presiding Officer, in any case, since he had decided to conduct his own inquiry halfway through our committee's work while still pretending to remain objective. A minor comment to Mr. Whittle about the famous painted windows. They were done at the request of the workers, nobody else. The workers wanted the ship to look as best it could for that particular occasion. So to level that at the government is just ridiculous. Now, I'll listen to you without any comment, Mr. Hoy, so you do me the same courtesy, for once, just for once. Show some courtesy and respect.
Mr. Coffey, we need to not refer to you, because that's me, and I don't think you're referring to me, so through the chair, Mr. Coffey.
My abiding memory of the evidence sessions we had on this issue was the conflicting nature of most of it, and the difficulty we all had in deciding who and what to believe. Inevitably, the risk is that you end up citing, no thank you. Did you hear me say no thank you?
Mr. Simpson, I think Mr. Coffey has made it quite clear that he's not taking the intervention. Mr. Coffey.
Inevitably, presiding officer, the risk is that you end up citing and emphasising the evidence that suits the political narrative that developed around the project. And that's a loss, in my view, to the overall purpose of audit and the obligation we have to the public to try and get to the bottom of things. The workers' reps at Ferguson's agreed when we met them last October that the Scottish Government's decision to award the contract saved the yard, saved hundreds of jobs, and saved shipbuilding in the Clyde. And most of us will agree with that. Curiously, that didn't manage to feature in the committee's report of our meeting, but it's worth putting this on record because it was Mr. Hoy who asked him the question. Presiding officer, if you want to try and get close to the reasons behind the delays to the ferries and the cost overrun, then we should ask the people who know the most, the workers and the current management team charged with delivering the ferries to completion. In their testimony to the committee, you'll see those answers fairly clearly. When we spoke to the workers' reps, they were clear that the problems occurred at the outset with the original management team's decisions and lack of consultation with the skilled workforce, who have many years' experience in successfully building ships in the Clyde. They said that due to the size of the contract for the two vessels, the yard would never be able to accommodate the two ferries at the same time. And with the significant changes required to reconfigure the yard, it was going to be impossible to meet those original timescales. This was confirmed again last week at the committee by the Chief Executive, David Tideman, who said that the mistakes made by the original FMEL in 2015 and FMPG in 2019 in relation to design management, build sequencing and contracting strategies effectively embedded unrecoverable delays into the programme. So the big question for all the partner agencies is, why did no one spot this at the outset and intervene to try and correct it? And I'm on record, my colleagues are on record, asking that question of the government and its agencies. One or two worrying aspects that stood out for me was the build sequencing, some of which seemed to be done purely to trigger payments rather than making sense in the construction process. And our predecessor, Rural Economy Committee, noted this in their report in the previous session. There were also various milestones along the way that were not tied to quality delivery. Presiding officer, in my role as a member of the Audit Committee and with some experience to draw on over many years in management systems and quality processes, it seems obvious to me that an essential part of any tendering process is that you conduct a full capability assessment on anyone wanting to deliver work for you. It's surely not enough to accept a tender without fully examining the capability of the contract bidder to deliver the order to the quality required and within the timescales and budget agreed. The committee recorded this important finding in our report. Presiding officer, if you don't get the project specification correct at the start, then it's unlikely you will deliver anything in time and on budget at the end. A maxim in any construction process, whether it's ships, bridges, schools, or anything else you intend to build. And that's one lesson that our committee has pointed to for many years. At the Audit Committee, our focus is principally on following the public pound and holding not only the government, but its agencies and delivery partners to account for how that money is spent. At the end of our inquiry, despite our best efforts collectively, even we as a committee couldn't reach a conclusion about how substantial parts of the £128 million referred to by the convener had been spent. And I pay tribute to my friend and colleague Colin Beattie for his forensic scrutiny of that in behalf of the committee. I do know the Auditor General is still considering that issue, and our committee will await his decision on whether he can continue to pursue this further. Presiding officer, in summary, this has been an extremely difficult inquiry for all of the members of the committee. We don't have direct expertise in shipbuilding and rely on those we invite in front of us to offer accurate testimony to help us in our scrutiny process. Inevitably, as I said earlier, the political dimension dominated the majority of the narrative around it and still does, much to the anger of the workers. And it's making it difficult to reach a consensus that would, in my view, have given us a stronger report for Parliament. All of the parties involved have lessons to learn, particularly to ensure that projects are rigorously defined at the outset. That's the key to success, in my view. I remain hopeful that the current management team led by the excellent Mr Tideman and the magnificent workers at Ferguson's, are allowed to get on with the job of completing these vessels for us and the public they are intended to serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Coffey. I now call Paul Sweeney to be followed by Alistair Allen. Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I commend the committee for its report and its recommendations. And it is painful to read it. It's painful for me, not just as a parliamentarian, but also as someone with a deep personal connection to Scotland's shipbuilding industry. My family have worked on the Clyde for generations, and it was a great moment of pride for me when I joined BE Systems to continue that tradition in 2011. And I was working at BE Systems in Govan in 2014 when Ferguson Marine went into administration. The previous shipbuilding company, Ferguson Shipbuilders Limited, went into administration and was rescued by the Scottish Government. And I think we all celebrated that moment. I think we all thought that was a good move because we all believed in the future of Scottish shipbuilding. But it's one thing to have sentiment and it's another thing to have competence. And that is the thing that has been sorely lacking in the last decade of the policies around the shipyard. And I think that's been clearly spelled out in the report. One of my jobs when I worked at BE Systems was to do benchmarking around different shipyards in the world. And that involved working with a company, an organisation called First Marine International, which I have a close connection with. And I know that they've been heavily involved in Ferguson Marine and trying to understand how to make it an effective shipbuilding operation. The recommendations from First Marine International were used by BE Systems and the Clyde to design what was known commonly as a frigate factory, but what was intended to be is a complete undercover shipbuilding system using a semi-tandem production methodology. Very complex to achieve, but we focused our efforts on trying to deliver it because we knew that was the basis on which world-class shipbuilding is undertaken anywhere else in the world. We needed to be upper quartile in the league table that is developed by First Marine International, go all around the world and maintain that benchmarking study. So we have developed that design. It certainly had a few false starts, but I'm now pleased to see that in Govan, planning consent has been granted and that the construction of a new integrated shipbuilding facility is underway, underpinned by a permanent and continuous shipbuilding programme that is financed through the Ministry of Defence for 8 Type 26 frigates. Now, I guess that is a contrast to what has happened at Ferguson Marine, and we can use that as a useful basis for now what we need to do. One thing looking at the report is one thing tearing lumps off of each other, but we have to actually raise our sights to what it is we want to do as a country. Do we want to have commercial shipbuilding in this country or not? That is the question I think we need to actually answer robustly. Do we want to have a national shipbuilding system? That is the question we need to come to a conclusion about, because if we want to do that, it's not good enough to simply say we want it. We need to put in place the building blocks for it. And first and foremost, we need a shipyard that is capable of undertaking the work. I think the member spoke previously, mentioned this, that, you know, I think it was mentioned actually, that to build a fit-for-purpose shipbuilding facility is either pie in the sky or it is essential, because certainly 801 and 802 were not capable of being built in the current shipbuilding facility. I've been to Ferguson on several occasions. It is not a shipyard that is fit for purpose. It is fundamentally too small. The workforce are fantastic. They are highly skilled indeed. Many of them are working between different shipyards and different programmes. They move around. It's a very small world shipbuilding in Scotland, as you can imagine. So it's nothing to do with the workforce and their skills, but we did not put in place the fundamentals, first of all, charged into a mighty Trojan horse of a project which has gone spectacularly wrong. And we are trying to recover our position. So the question is, do we put in place the necessary finance, capital, to build a world-class shipbuilding facility, as I'm sure First Marine International have presented on numerous occasions of what is needed to be done to do that? Do we put in place the essential financing? Now, it's often been a point of criticism that Ferguson Marine did not have in place a builder's refund guarantee, which is the financial cornerstone for any shipbuilding project in the commercial world. But the reality is no British bank provides builder's refund guarantees. It is not a financial product offered in Britain. RBS used to do it all the time. In fact, RBS was one of the world's biggest ship financing institutions, but after the 2008 crash, withdrew from it completely. I asked the Minister only a matter of weeks ago Would the Scottish National Investment Bank put in place a facility for builders' refund guarantees so that Scottish shipyards could actually undertake commercial work? He said that they are not minded to do so at this point. Well, I ask, well, if we are intending to be a commercial shipbuilding nation, if we don't have the fundamental cornerstone of financing in place, then we can't do it. And that is part of the reason why this has never worked. So facilities aren't adequate, financing isn't in place, and a patient forward programme isn't in place because the current procurement system is not set up to allow Scottish businesses to win. It's not allowing Scottish builders to win, and that's why we have the perverse spectacle of over £200 million of public money flowing into the Scottish economy to build ferries there, when we know from economic studies that for every pound spent on a shipbuilding programme in this country, it returns £1.30 in value. So we're cutting our own throats here. If we're a parliament here that was set up to try and build and grow the Scottish economy and try and build prosperity for our communities, then this is a singular failure that we should be trying to learn from. And we should be understanding what the solutions are. The facilities need to be put in place in a way which is competitive. The financing needs to be put in place in a way which is competitive. And the procurement needs to be structured in such a way that allows for series build, allows for those efficiencies to be gained. Now, between the first of the Type 45 destroyers, which we worked on at BE, and the sixth, we saved something of the order of 30% in man hours. That shows you what you can achieve with a continuous ship build programme. That is what needs to be put in place for us to succeed, and that is why it is so essential that the government finds a means and a way to get the small vessel replacement programme structured in such a way that it can be delivered by Ferguson Marine on an equivalent national shipbuilding champion in the commercial world, so that it can be basically a conveyor belt of production, so that the workers can achieve the learning curves, and it can be underpinned by the financing and the facilities that are fit for purpose. That is it. If we can get those things in place, then we can be a successful commercial shipbuilding country again. So whilst we can ruminate and chastise everyone about the failures that have happened over the last decade, the solutions are staring us in the face. That we've achieved it with naval shipbuilding, we can achieve it in commercial shipbuilding. I urge the Minister and all colleagues here to collaborate constructively to achieve that for us all.
Thank you. I call Alistair Allen to be followed by Jamie Green.
Presiding Officer, it is as well to start off, as we have all done in several previous ferries debates, with a frank acknowledgement of the situation faced. Many of us were in this chamber in October 2015 to hear the contract award announcement for vessels 801 and 802. I doubt whether any of us, in even our uneasiest dreams, could have imagined that we might be here nearly 8 years later discussing the circumstances of those two vessels' ongoing construction. If I can begin a sentence or two first, thank you. The Public Audit Committee's report we are debating today adds to the work done by the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee's inquiry in Session 5 and the Auditor General for Scotland's report in March of last year. As the Audit Scotland report notes, procuring both vessels at the same time was intended to be the start of a standardised approach to building new vessels for CalMac. The contract was for a combined £97 million for both ships, with delivery due in May and July of 2018. These were, of course, intended to be the first of a series of vessels which would have seen the average age of CMAL's major vessels reduced from 21 years in 2017 to 12 years by 2025. Now, instead, as is very well but very fairly rehearsed, island communities have, of course, been left waiting for new vessels during that period. And as a result of the sequence of events that we've gone through today, of course, many island communities are still depending on vessels like MV Isle of Arran for network resilience. That, for those of you who do not know her, is a vessel so old that she predates the emergence of Apple PCs and commercial camcorders. Now, I spend a great proportion of my life raising concerns about the ferry network, something which is a measure of just how essential ferries are for every aspect of island life. This reliance on an ageing and overstretched fleet is, of course, having real and serious consequences for my constituents. Now, CalMac crews and shore staff do an outstanding job, but CalMac themselves as a company can and should be doing much better for island communities. This winter's annual refit programme has been one of the most chaotic in living memory, and it has shown itself to be maddeningly inflexible to changing circumstances. And the latest decision to deprive South Uist of its ferry service entirely again for all of June is one example of why island voices are increasingly, as we've all seen, being raised to use phrases like out of touch and remote when describing CalMac's upper management. Now, Presiding Officer, I don't mention all of that, the operation of ferry services, to deflect from the undeniable reality that CalMac does not have enough ships to fulfil its duties as an operator, or even at present to sail from all the ferry ports advertised on its timetable. And I do welcome, however, the news that Glen Sannox, however belatedly, now shows signs of being ready for this autumn, and that progress with vessel 802 suggests she might be in service late next year, just as I do also warmly welcome the award of contracts to build a further four new vessels, construction of two of which is now well underway. The Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy's decision to give a ministerial direction for vessel 802 to be completed at Ferguson's was, despite much bluster in this chamber today and previously from some quarters, the right thing to do. It may very well have cost less to start again and build elsewhere. However, the costs of waiting the necessary 2 or probably 3 years extra to do so would have been borne by island communities and businesses as they continued to deal with disruption. The Public Audit Committee agreed with the REC Committee that the decision-making structure for the procurement and construction of new vessels to serve the Clyde and Hebrides ferries network is cluttered and lacks transparency. The landscape of differing responsibilities of Scottish ministers, civil servants, CMAL, CalMac and Transport Scotland is, in my view, and that of many others, very complex indeed. And I hope that the work underway to review governance arrangements through Project Neptune provides an opportunity to set some of this right. Angus Campbell from the Ferry Users Community Board has been diligently going around the country to ensure community input into any future reform. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want, firstly on a personal note, to thank the outgoing Transport Minister for the very considerable efforts he made in office to engage with many island communities, including my own, and wish him all the best for an improvement in his health. And Presiding Officer, I also want to conclude by saying that everyone in the islands is painfully aware, believe you me, of the failings associated with the buildings of the Glen Sannox and Vessel 802. They are failings for which there have been undoubted consequences, both economically and socially, for my constituents. But they also raise wider questions too about how we make sure that in the future the management of ferry service by CalMac itself is done more effectively. Not least, if I can be entirely frank about this, and others have mentioned this, I hope that CalMac will take the hint that there is something far wrong with the matrix that it uses to decide which ferry services to abandon at any given time, given that it's generally the same ferry service that's abandoned. Anyway, all of these are questions which Government and CalMac alike will need to address in order to ensure that we do have the ferry services that we need for the years ahead. And on that note, I will conclude, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Jamie Green to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the previous two speakers for their contributions? One of the most striking comments ever made by a witness to a parliamentary committee inquiry was in late 2020, when the witness was posed the question why the outcome of a hugely valuable public procurement exercise, which named its price up front, would produce a winning bid which was deemed to be both highest in quality and highest in price. The witness in response said the following: I do not know the answer, but three things spring to mind. One is incompetence, another is vested interest, and the final one is corruption. Now, you could construe that as an abstract or even unfair critique of the government, but is there perhaps any truth to it? Because I think it sums up this entire fiasco in three damning accusations. All 129 pages of the aptly named Construction and Procurement of Ferries in Scotland report, penned by the last Parliament's Rural Economy Committee, made for damning reading. and I declare an interest because I co-authored it. There was an equally critical Transport Committee report as far back as 2008, when one Mr. Patrick Harvey, MSP himself, oversaw the production of that report, back in the days when the Greens had some backbone. They see they couldn't even be bothered turning up today, presiding officer. And of course there have been many more indictments of the situation since last year's Audit Scotland report and this latest 125-page instalment by this Parliament's Public Audit Committee, a granular, forensic piece of work. All reports which have gathered dust on the shelves of numerous respective transport ministers' shelves, because the key protagonists of this whole sorry saga lie in three camps. The first were those who were thrown under the proverbial bus, not here to defend themselves today, and by that I reference Paul Wheelhouse and Derek Mackay. The second, whose transport failures in office were instead rewarded by the heady heights of high office, and anyone who listened to today's FMQs best illustrate that. But those who I respect are the real authors of this entire mess, are those who sat at the very top of government, those who signed the cheques, those who announced the deal at party conference before the deal had even been signed, those who ironically smashed a bottle of iron whiskey against the hull of 801 some 6 years ago, and those who occupy the government's backbenches when they're not popping up on daytime chat shows. And I note not one of them had the guts or the shame to turn up to this Parliament today to defend themselves or their actions. Three devastating charges, presiding officer, three. The first was incompetence, the incompetence of numerous ministers who could not sit CMAL, FMEL or Transport Scotland around the table to either negotiate or oversee or manage disputes amongst the three of them. In a second, the incompetence of making payments for milestones which had either artificially been reached or had not even been met at all, the incompetence of so-called loans, which would knowingly, clearly would never be paid back, or were even being used for purposes other than that for which they were intended, the incompetence of insisting on engine technology, which was the source of so much cost and so much delay, and of course, over which there is still so much doubt over its use or efficacy. Happy to give away to the member.
Russell Findlay.
Thank you for giving way. Now, Nicola Sturgeon and John Swinney hijacked the yard for and its workers for politics and PR. I'd like to ask the member if he knows when's the last time either of them showed face at Ferguson's.
Yeah. Jamie Green.
I suspect they haven't got the guts to show face at Mr. Findlay, because they know exactly that their actions and the government's and their agency's actions have paved the way for the disaster that we see ourselves in now. And that's why I come on to my second charge named in that evidence session. And that was of vested interest, because this is a relevant point. We do not know what Alex Salmond promised Jim McCall back in the heady day of 2014. We do not know what Nicola Sturgeon promised Jim McCall in 2015 or 2016 or even 2017, as the report alludes to, because there are no minutes of those meetings. The Scottish Government and its agencies, which don't forget the Scottish Government being the biggest creditor to the yard, saw it spiral into administration under its own watch, presiding officer. The vested interest that hid from scrutiny behind the cloak of commercial confidentiality every step of the way. Ministers were given 29 options to resolve the yard's financial problems, all presented to them independently by PricewaterhouseCoopers. They instead forced their way into the boardroom of the yard and took control. And what about the vested interests of the turnaround directors? The only thing that turned around in this was their personal fortunes. And we will never know where that huge pipeline of commercial prospective work went. Where are all the RFIs? Where are all the tender responses that were piled up in Ferguson's boardroom whiteboard? We never found out what the effect that state ownership would actually have on the yard's ability to compete for commercial work. We never got a response to the CMA's warnings about directly awarding contracts. We never found out why Jim McCall's offer to buy the yard back, even one just a couple of weeks ago, went unnoticed and unresponsive. We never even know who else bid for the yard before the government nationalised it. But all the while, and members are right to point this out, the good workers and grafters of that yard, under direction, were welding pieces of ship completely out of kilter from what they knew to be right, under direction, just so the First Minister could turn up for a photo shoot. But it is that third and final most grievous charge that I must raise the Chamber's awareness to, and that is that of corruption. Because only,
Only in Scotland could you get away with a decade-long scandal like this, and not one single person has lost their job. Not one single person has paid the price for this sorry saga. Well, I lie. Taxpayers have paid the price, and our island communities, islanders on Arran, who have to wait and turn up and see if their ferry's running and if they're lucky enough to get on it. Let's not forget that the whole Northern Irish government fell and collapsed after a renewable heat scandal which cost their taxpayers a couple of hundred million pounds. I suspect in here that would barely make a topical question. Presiding officer, all the while here in Edinburgh, we've got ministers. Ministers who get around Scotland's ferry problems. What do? They just charter them to get around instead. That is the reality check of what is happening in this current government versus what is happening in our island communities. And I hear them moaning because they don't like the truth, presiding officer. This latest report, and a damning one at that, is the last of such many. It lays bare the simple truth on all three counts of incompetence, of vested interest, and of corruption. This government is undoubtedly guilty as charged, presiding officer.
I call Rona Mackay, the final speaker in the open debate.
We'll have some sense now. Thank you, presiding officer. Before I start my contribution, I tried to intervene earlier on Craig Hoy to ask if he thought it was respectful or fair to constantly refer to a member who's not in the chamber because he's ill and has no recourse to reply. I thought that was shameful. Presiding officer, I'm speaking today not to rake over the coals of what's happened on the hugely important issue of ferries. The committee convener and members have addressed many aspects of the challenges leading up to where we are now, and rightly so. Ministers have apologised for the delay to the ferries and the distress and difficulties caused. But I'd like to repeat what the Cabinet Secretary said in his opening speech. The Scottish Government will never apologise for taking action to save more than 300 jobs at Ferguson Shipyard. So today's debate is about how we move forward by standing by our commitment to the shipbuilding communities in Inverclyde and our island communities that rely on the vessels currently being built at Ferguson's. The completion of vessels 801 and 802 will provide a high-quality lifeline service to our island communities, who I know are having a desperate time right now. Speaking as someone who represents an urban mainland constituency, I honestly can't imagine what islanders are going through, and I hope the situation is urgently remedied for very obvious reasons. No, I'm not taking interventions, thanks. No, thank you. Presiding officer, there's no doubt that our island communities deserve to be supported by two new energy-efficient vessels with the capacity and reliability required to support vibrant island economies.
Can I ask that members refrain from making remarks from a sedentary position? Please continue.
Thank you,
Ms. Mackay.
While the pure value for money assessment on vessel 802 is challenging, no doubt about that, the government had to take a very finely balanced decision. We must take into account the added delays, the wider benefits of continuing the vessel's build at Ferguson Marine, or the full cost of not doing so. A new vessel couldn't be deployed until at least May 2027 at the earliest, 4 years from now and 2.5 years from the current delivery timescale. It just wouldn't be acceptable to ask our island communities to wait this further period. We all know they've waited long enough. Vessel 802 will provide lifeline connectivity to the mainland, ensure that A new vessel could not be deployed until at least Vessel 802 will provide lifeline connectivity to the mainland, ensure that people on the beautiful island of Arran are supported for day-to-day needs around health, education and commercial activity, and provide a resilient service to support the tourist industry, which contributes so much to the island's economy. Recent issues with the reliability of an ageing island fleet and the costs associated with hiring replacement vessels in order to maintain services have merely added to the compelling case for delivering additional capacity as quickly as possible. And that's why the Scottish Government has issued a written authority to continue to complete delivery of both vessels at Ferguson Marine. The project costs to complete them are currently estimated to be £202.6 million, including contingency. So the publication of the Public Audit Committee's report, New Vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides Arrangements to Delivery Hulls 801 and 802, was welcome, and I congratulate them on a thorough and balanced report. It recognised that there have already been significant improvements in procedures and processes by Transport Scotland and Caledonia Maritime Assets Limited since the procurement of these vessels almost 8 years ago. Both organisations, along with CalMac Ferries Limited, are committed to continuing to build on these improvements and, in particular, how the communities and stakeholders are embedded in the process, and that value for money for taxpayers underpins investment decisions. The Scottish Government supports the growth of commercial shipbuilding in Scotland, and why wouldn't we with our proud shipbuilding heritage? The Scottish Government is in active engagement with Audit Scotland in strengthening the business investment framework within the Scottish Public Finance Manual and will agree an action plan with them to increase transparency and further enhance this framework to ensure a consistent approach to future investment while ensuring ministers have appropriate flexibility to intervene to support industries and communities. Of course, any decision on further audit work is for the Auditor General of Scotland, but all parties will fully engage in any work identified. And in response to some of the remarks made today, the Scottish Government is committed to transparency and has proactively published more than 200 documents on its website.
Members, if you care to look.
In conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scottish Ministers have taken action to ensure the completion of two ferries by Ferguson Marine following a due diligence assessment carried out on forecast costs, and I believe this is entirely the right decision. Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray has clearly outlined the Scottish Government's commitment to supporting the completion of the vessels, which remain the quickest way of introducing new lifeline connectivity for island communities. So I look forward to the delivery of these two vital vessels as soon as possible, and I thank the skilled workers working so hard to make this happen. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are grateful to the Public Audit Committee and their staff for their work on this report. Presiding Officer, the workforce at Ferguson's have been let down by this government. Stuart McMillan seemed to suggest that people in this chamber were hammering the workers at the yard, but they're not. They're hammering his government, and if he tries diverting that anger, it is him that is causing distress to the workers at the yard. The workforce at CalMac have been let down as well, but those who have been most let down are the communities that are being driven to their knees by the lack of ferries. Neil Bibby and others talked about the unprecedented protests in South Uist. A turnout of a third of the population is unheard of anywhere, and yet that's what happened in South Uist at the weekend. They've had enough. This has to be fixed. They need ferries. And it won't be fixed without a transport minister. So why the delay in appointing one? Can the First Minister really not find a willing candidate on the backbenches? Richard Leonard talked about the committee report and the lack of transparency, the evasion, how they avoided questions, how they even refused to attend. They did not even have the courtesy to respond in time and in detail to this committee report. If this is how the Scottish Government treat the Public Audit Committee of this Parliament, I begin to wonder. But it is exactly the way they also treated Audit Scotland. We need transparency. This is the squandering of public money and the betrayal of communities. Neil Bibby and Craig Coy added their voices in condemnation of Willie Coffey and Colin Beattie, who tried to water down the report. Their role on the Audit Committee is to represent the people of Scotland, not the SNP. And for the Minister to tell us today that CIMA will decide on which parts of the KC report will be published is absolutely shocking. This is a failing government trying to hide the truth. The Scottish Government are squandering taxpayers' money. The cost of the Glen Sannox and Hull 802 would have been almost enough to renew the whole fleet. And bizarrely, they're also paying Pentland Ferries an amount for a 9 months hire that would have pretty much bought the boat. Brian Whittle talked about paying for consultants. Yes, they've paid for consultants on Project Neptune. Now they're going out to another procurement for millions of pounds for more consultants. Wasted money when a bystander could tell them, for free, what we need is ships. It's the only way to solve the problem. They need to sign off a design that will fit harbours, put a running programme of replacement out to tender and build an interchangeable fleet with capacity to cover dry dock and high season. Doing that will invest in shipbuilding, a point made by Paul Sweeney in the debate. At this moment, it doesn't really matter who runs the contract. You can't provide a service without boats. So while the Scottish Government loves to point fingers at CalMac, they're simply passing the buck for their own incompetence. Alistair Allen talked, and the Scottish Government talked about the matrix and put blame on that. But if you change the matrix, you simply cut off another community, pitting communities against each other. We're already pitting tourists against locals, freight against passengers. Divide and rule simply will not work.
Alistair Allen.
Thank the member for giving way. I hope she's not entirely surprised that I'm standing up for a community in my constituency who finds themselves on the receiving end of the matrix.
Roger Grant.
I am trying very hard to stand up for every community in my constituency because they all need ferries and none of them deserve to be cut off because of incompetence. You know, and this isn't just a waste of public money, you know, squandering of public money on ferries that may never sail. The economic damage to our communities is immeasurable. In US, bus tours have stopped coming. Buses carrying 40 people at a time for hotels and B&Bs. Visitors are cancelling, not because they don't want to come, but because they cannot come. Hospital appointments are being missed. People are missing their chemotherapy appointments. Shelves are empty, weddings are missed, and funerals are missed, as Willie Rennie said. And where is the compensation for these businesses? Now, they say, we don't want compensation. What we want is ferries. But without the ferries, what they need is compensation. Communities are being damaged by this government, a government that should actually be protecting them. And the staff are facing abuse. The staff who are trying to serve these communities are at the brunt of the frustration of people desperate to travel who can't. So I would say to people, do not take it out on the staff. Take it out on this government who have let you down. This whole fiasco shows the reality of a government that's not focused on the needs of the people it should be serving. It's a disgrace that people are cut off, that livelihoods have been damaged, and the whole island economy is being wrecked. It doesn't have to be like this, and yet the Scottish Government avoid responsibility. They seek to sow further division, pitting community against community and sector against sector. They need to stop. They need to step up and help our island communities. They need to provide compensation and they need to provide ferries.
Thank you. I call on Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I also thank the Public Audit Committee for what was an excellent report. Rarely has there been such a scathing committee report, but rarely has there been such a scandal to report on. In fact, in my view, there hasn't been one. Now, the committee blasts what it calls significant failings. That is rather stating the obvious. They said, quotes, the vessels are now millions of pounds over budget and years behind schedule. Scotland's taxpayers and island communities have been badly let down by many of those involved in the project. Correct. They said there was a lack of transparency, a lack of accountability. There was the issue of the lack of a builder's refund guarantee and ignoring CMAL's wish to re-tender. The committee questioned the former First Minister's decision to publicly announce the preferred bidder when she did. They said there is still uncertainty over which minister had the final sign-off on the contract. Still uncertainty. They branded the programme steering group, which was led by Transport Scotland, as weak and toothless. And of course, there were meddling ministers, none of whom has taken the rap. A good quartet of fiddlers can make sweet music, but Mackay, Swinney, Brown and Sturgeon have struck a bum note with Islanders throughout this sorry saga. At least Mr. Mackay came to give his side of the story to committee, as did Ms. Sturgeon. Sadly, the committee's efforts to pin down Keith Brown came to nothing, leading to the committee to chide him for his lack of cooperation. What did Canteen Keith, last seen stirring up constitutional
Mr. Simpson, we will address members by their proper full names and we will not use nicknames in the chamber.
What did Canteen Keith Brown, last seen stirring up constitutional
Mr. Simpson, I would ask you to apologise and then move on.
I will apologise. What did Keith Brown, last seen stirring up constitutional grievance in a members' debate and making a spurious point of order, have to hide? Quite a lot, I suspect. Isn't it significant that none of the key players in this saga who still belong to this Parliament are here today to face the music? And it's a sorry saga indeed, with ultimately no ferries yet and hundreds of millions of pounds of our money squandered. And for what? All because the SNP were hell-bent on giving that yard the contract, even though it plainly wasn't the right thing to do. But it gave ministers, including Humza Yousaf, Mr. Mackay and the selfie queen herself, Ms. Sturgeon, the chance to get their pictures taken in hard hats. Of course, the most infamous of those was the fake launch by Nicola Sturgeon in 2017, known as the Painted on Windows launch, but 6 years later, still no ferries. My advice to anyone who has to take a decision is to keep SNP ministers well away when the Glen Sannox is actually launched into service, hopefully next year. As the committee said, there's been a shroud of secrecy hanging over aspects of this. There was the meeting between the discredited former First Minister and Jim McColl, for which there is no minute. Craig Hoy was quite right to say she may have broken the ministerial code, but we have a broken system where the First Minister marks their own homework and that of wayward ministers. That must change. We've also discovered through FOI that a meeting between Transport Scotland and CMAL officials on September the 29th, 2015, just days before Ferguson's was awarded the contract, was also not minuted. Whatever could the reason be for such an oversight? We know the SNP ministers, SNP members of the committee tried to water down the report. That's not their job, and they should be ashamed of themselves. No amount of spin and bluster can hide the fact that this is the biggest public spending scandal of the devolution age. The project was, of course, cleared once John Swinney was sure there were no banana skins. There were so many banana skins, you would think the vessels had already sailed to South America and back. Chance would be a fine thing. Aaron would do. All the time, the islanders are without a ferry and the costs go up and up. And we've had the BBC disclosure programme claiming that Ferguson's was given preferential treatment when it won the contract. And we now learn that it will be cheaper to start again rather than complete 802 at Port Glasgow. But of course, we have not been told the figures. We can't assess that decision. That would amount to transparency, and this government doesn't do that, of course. Now, to listen to SNP members today, with the exception of Alistair Allen, you would think that nothing had gone wrong. The government had done absolutely nothing wrong at all. But at least we've had some plain speaking from Craig Hoy, Neil Bibby, Willie Rennie, Brian Whittle, and the only Green in the chamber today, Jamie Green. But we need to look to the future, presiding officer. What does the future hold for the yard? And again, trying to get an answer on that from the government is absolutely impossible, because Mr. Gray will not tell us what he thinks the future holds. We've had the Project Neptune report but we don't know what his conclusion is. We do know that there is still a bottomless pit, a blank check, and it seems it will go on and on. I'm just finishing, Mr. Sweeney. It is a scandal, the biggest scandal of the devolution age, and somebody has to take responsibility.
And I call on Neil Gray, 7 minutes or so, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. May I begin by echoing my opening remarks and thank Richard Leonard and the Public Audit Committee for their resolute scrutiny of Scotland's ferry sector. Can I also add my thanks to the Auditor-General and his team for the quality and depth of their work over recent years. Their scrutiny has enabled debates such as the one we have held here today, and I think that this Parliament can be proud of the role it has played in improving the way in which the Scottish Government manages its strategic commercial assets and delivers vital services to our communities. I had hoped, though, that whilst we were undoubtedly going to hear a variety of different opinions today, that this Parliament should have been united in its determination to support island communities and retain the proud tradition of shipbuilding on the Clyde. As Willie Coffey said, and I pay tribute to Willie Coffey and Colin Beattie, as I do all other members of committees of this Parliament, who consider the evidence that is before them and take judgments based on that evidence. And I thank them, and I think it is shameful that those contributions are denigrated, because as he said, this issue has become so polarised and politicised that unfortunately I don't even think that I can say that the proud tradition of shipbuilding on the Clyde is supported unanimously in this Parliament. But I can assure colleagues, we are committed to expanding and improving the resilience of lifeline services provided to island communities. And Alistair Allen pointed out in his excellent speech why that is so important. We are committed to securing a sustainable and successful future for the Yard, and committed to providing opportunities for future generations to learn and practice skills and trades that can define our future as much as they distinguish our past. And in that regard, I also want to thank Paul Sweeney for his contribution, his speech, and in particular his reference to raising our eyes and asking if we want to see commercial shipbuilding on the Clyde in future. I can assure him and colleagues that we do. We want a yard to improve productivity and compete successfully for new work as it becomes available. And in that regard, I also agree with Neil Bibby's contribution in terms of his plea for greater accountability and responsibility to deliver the ferries. I agree took the decision on providing written authority for 802 for that very purpose. And we'll keep working with him, with Paul Sweeney, with Stuart McMillan, the other local representatives, to ensure that we work with the management and the staff at the Yard to deliver those ferries within the timescale the management has outlined for us, and support them with a forward work programme. So I am also encouraged that in his evidence to the Public Audit Committee last week, David Tideman, the Chief Executive of Ferguson Marine, suggested that there was at least £250 million of work available for the Yard to compete for. That is a prize worth fighting for. And I know that this Parliament will support the efforts of the workforce to attract as much of that business as possible, of course.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank the Minister for giving way on that point. There's lots of shipbuilding work out there in the world to be won. The point is, Scotland won't win any of it unless we have competitive facilities that are invested in, no investments taking place in Ferguson or an alternative shipbuilding location in the area. And there's no builders' refund guarantees available in the Scottish economy right now. So what are we going to do? Fix those fundamentals so we can win some of that £200 million plus business and get some work into those yards.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Paul Sweeney for that contribution. I'll absolutely consider his point around financing. And we are considering the request that has been made for capital investment into the Yard. He's right that in order to ensure greater productivity in the Yard, there needs to be investment. We've got difficulties with regards to that, as he will be aware, around ensuring state subsidy. We need to be careful around what we do there. But we're taking those considerations, and he can, and other colleagues should rest assured that we will do what we can to make sure that yard is competitive as possible. As Rona Mackay said, my decision to provide a written authority to continue building Hull 802 at Ferguson at Marine Port Glasgow was a clear demonstration of the Government's determination to give the Yard the support it needs to create a successful future. I say to Craig Hoy and Brian Whittle that narrow value for money assessment, as they know, does not consider, as I'm sure they would support me in placing significant value upon, the impact on the Yard and the local economy and, of course, the island communities who have to be at the centre of these considerations. I took a decision that was in the interests of our island communities first and foremost, a decision that would protect them from the potential delay of up to 2.5 years that would have followed, had we decided to go through the complex, time-consuming process of procuring an alternative vessel. And of course, I took a decision that was in the interests of the Yard, its dedicated workforce and the community in and around Port Glasgow. They have been through a lot over the past few years, and I wanted to give them a degree of certainty and provide a platform upon which they can build a successful future. I'll give way briefly to Mr. Simpson.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Is he prepared today, as he's not been previously, to say how much it will cost to complete 802 at the Yard?
Cabinet Secretary.
The information in terms of the estimation from the Yard is in the public domain already. And of course, I will do what I can, as I've committed to doing both at committee previously and today, to look at what more information can be published going forward. No, I know that the decision that I took I need to watch my time. I'll see if I can come back to Mr. McMillan if I've got time before I conclude. No one is pretending that there haven't been mistakes over many years in the delivery of these two new vessels. Audit Scotland have been both clear and constructive in the way in which they have identified things that could have been done differently, and I give colleagues an assurance that we are equally as clear in our determination to listen to their suggestions and learn lessons from their reports. That is the best way of ensuring that we provide the services that people have the right to expect and guarantee the future of a proud industry with an illustrious past and, I believe, an exciting future. I'll give way to Stuart McMillan before I close.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. Cabinet Secretary, I want to put on record the thanks of the community in Port Glasgow, but also the workforce, for the decision that was taken very recently regarding Hull 802. When I met up with shop stewards and GMB reps last week, that point was made very clear, and I want to put that on record to the Scottish Government.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Stuart McMillan for that, that is appreciated. But my appreciation is to, like Stuart McMillan, to the workforce for their contribution, the hard work and dedication of the people who work in Scotland's ferry sector. I want to acknowledge how difficult it must have been for them to read and hear the negative press and some of the comments in this place today, quite frankly, on such a regular basis. That cannot be easy. I want them all, those who work in the ferries, looking after passengers, those who manage the complex logistics, those who maintain or repair the ferries, and those crafting and building the new ferries for Scotland's seas, I want to say thank you. We're very lucky to have this whole industry working together in the service of Scotland's seas, and I want to keep it that way.
Thank you, and I call on Sharon Dowie to wind up on behalf of the Public Audit Committee. 8 minutes or so, Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To start, can I thank the clerking team for the huge amount of work that they've put into compiling this report, and also Audit Scotland for their input, and can also thank all members around the Chamber for their contributions today, and can I say how reassuring it is that so many across the Chamber are committed to the scrutiny of the issues raised in the report. While I'm pleased to be closing the debate on behalf of the Public Audit Committee, it is with considerable regret that this Parliament is debating, once again, two vessels that should have set sail 5 years ago and are currently 3.5 times over budget. The significant failings throughout this project have let islanders down and have caused disruption to their everyday lives, and lessons must be learned. I start by echoing the concerns expressed by the convener about the Scottish Government's response to our report. So short is the response that of a 7-page document, only around half of it addresses the committee's key findings, conclusions and recommendations. The rest of it merely reproduces large sections of our report and lacks the detail we would have hoped for. Take, for example, the committee's serious concerns about Transport Scotland's role in the project. As CMAL's sponsor, Transport Scotland had a critical role in communicating important information to Scottish ministers on its behalf.
We are clear that it consistently failed to reflect CMAL's significant concerns to Scottish ministers, whether this be in relation to the high-profile public announcement of FMEL as the preferred bidder or the awarding of the contract to FMEL. Given the extent of the concerns raised by CMAL regarding the financial risks associated with the contract, Transport Scotland should have sought written authority from Scottish ministers before any further progress was made with the project. Indeed, as it materialised, the absence of a full builder's refund guarantee, coupled with no general quality standards in the contract, resulted in CMAL's position being significantly weakened when problems with the standard of FMEL's work became apparent. And these points were covered in detail in Brian Whittle and Jamie Green's contributions. No comment is offered at all in relation to any of these concerns. The Scottish Government's response does, however, highlight the recent approach taken to the written authority provided to secure the continued build of Vessel 802 at FMPG. Indeed, it is recognised that the Scottish Public Finance Manual has specific requirements for the notification of any instance of written authority, which must be drawn to the attention of the Auditor-General, and I welcome that this was adhered to. I also take this opportunity to reiterate the Committee's call for the Scottish Government to follow the UK Government's example in proactively publishing the list of all occasions when written authority was sought on its website to improve openness and transparency in this area. Turning next to the Committee's concerns about the Scottish Government's commitment to paying additional vessel costs regardless of the final price. While the Scottish Government has challenged this assertion, the Committee remains concerned about the ongoing significant risk that costs will continue to rise. This, of course, is now proving to be the case, with the former Deputy First Minister announcing in March that an additional £6 million would be allocated in the 2022-23 financial year. This comes alongside the more recent announcement by the Cabinet Secretary in May, which clarified that additional money will be allocated during the current financial year following a process of due diligence. It is extremely disappointing that at no point does the Scottish Government's response address the Committee's well-founded concerns about these soaring and still unknown final costs. And Willie Rennie raised his concerns of a blank cheque being written, which is also a concern of the Committee. The Scottish Government's response does, however, welcome, and I quote, the report's recognition that there have been significant improvements in procedures and processes by Transport Scotland and CMAL since the procurement of vessels 801 and 802.
A quick one. Jamie Green.
Thank you to the member for taking intervention. I mean, what is clear, I think, to everyone is that one of the main and principal drivers of the catastrophic failings in this process was the breakdown in relationships between the main protagonists, CMAL, Transport Scotland, and the Scottish Government, and the manufacturers, and probably CalMac as well. Did the committee give any consideration as to what future changes could be done to that relationship to ensure that those breakdown relationships don't happen again?
Sharon Dowie.
That was covered in the committee's report, and it's been noted that there has been an improvement in the relationship between them, but we obviously need to keep tabs on that. It would be fairer to say that the report notes some signs of progress. For example, we're encouraged that there appear to be signs of more constructive relations between the new management and the workforce and between FMPG and CMAL. However, the committee wants to see much more progress to ensure that this situation never happens again. In addition, while we note the action taken by the Scottish Government to publish a business investment framework to strengthen its approach to investment in private businesses, we are clear that the work doesn't stop there. That's why we're calling for more to be done to strengthen the framework to better outline intentions over risk tolerance, risk appetite, and the expected public benefit of future interventions. While the Government's response indicates that it is in active engagement with Audit Scotland on this matter, it is unclear how or indeed when this will be achieved. I turn next to the intervention of several Scottish ministers throughout the project, on which a majority of committee members raised concerns. Central to these concerns is a lack of transparency around why certain decisions were taken. whether this be a lack of documentary evidence to clarify why the former First Minister led on the very public announcement of the preferred bidder, a lack of documentary evidence to explain why Scottish ministers accepted the risks associated in approving the award of the contract to FMail, or that a full record of a meeting between the former director of FMail and the former First Minister does not appear to exist. Even more challenging is that poor record-keeping means that the Scottish public and this Parliament are in the dark about what exactly happened at some crucial stages of the project. While it is encouraging that the Scottish Government has issued new guidance on the recording of decisions, we are unanimous in calling on the Scottish Government to further review and refine its record-keeping procedures. This would facilitate scrutiny and improve both transparency and accountability. I share the concerns expressed by the convener that the Scottish Government's response to this recommendation does not provide the committee with any meaningful detail on how this is being addressed. As the convener has already set out, a number of developments have taken place since our report was published, and it is clear that further developments will follow. Notwithstanding our own continued scrutiny of the Auditor General's Section 22 report and FMPG, we await with interest the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee's forthcoming report on a modern and sustainable ferry service for Scotland and the next steps associated with the Project Neptune Governance Review. It is encouraging that the Government shares the Committee's opinion that this review does not represent a silver bullet in preventing a similar situation from occurring again. Do I have time to cover members' contributions, or do you want me to close?
You have time, Ms Dowie.
Okay. To cover some of the contributions from other members, Graeme Simpson spoke of the lack of transparency, accountability and the lack of a builder's refund guarantee, and that was mentioned by quite a few members across the chamber. Craig Hoy also spoke of the insufficient evidence to explain why ministers made the decision, and again, that's something that the committee wants to have more transparency. He also mentioned island communities now paying the price, and that was something that was also mentioned in contributions from a lot of people around the chamber, Rhoda Grant, Alistair Allen, Neil Bibby and Stuart McMillan. Stuart McMillan also raised concerns that the shipyard was being criticised, but could I say to Stuart McMillan that the criticism in the report was with those ministers and government bodies who took the decisions, it wasn't the workforce. Paul Sweeney also mentioned... Paul Sweeney also mentioned the point, if we want to be a shipbuilding nation, then we need to look at the basics. And Rhoda Grant, in her contribution, actually said we need to sign off a design that will fit harbours. So she should maybe have been at the procurement process. It would have maybe helped. So in closing, I take the opportunity to restate the committee's call for a formal review of the project to be undertaken upon completion of the vessels. And this will help the Scottish Government learn vital lessons for the future so that Scotland's taxpayers and island communities can have confidence in the procurement and construction of future vessels. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on new vessels for the Clyde and the Hebrides, arrangements to deliver vessels 801 and 802. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 9371 and 9372 on committee remits.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. And I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. And I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
I'm happy to do so, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first is that motion 9375, in the name of Angus Robertson, on retained EU law, revocation and reform bill, UK legislation, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.